meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you all for this setup. I didn't even really ask, but this is wonderful. I appreciate this very much. I'm feeling very lonely right now. Thank you. Okay, so we're looking at Philippians today, is the best reading I've been looking at. This past month, while our parish has been working our way through a sermon series on how the love got back, the New Testament lectionary readings have been quietly moving through the book of Philippians. And it's interesting, I find it interesting that much of Paul's letter also has to do with love. When Paul talks about love for the Philippians love for Paul, Philippians love for each other, and of course loving God back. So there's a good bit of that in here too. So today we're in the fourth and final chapter of Philippians, having missed the first three. So I need to kind of back up and just give us a little bit of context on this. Paul's letter to the Philippians is a letter that is filled with joy. Probably one of the few letters that Paul wrote that's published in the Bible, where he's not addressing some kind of crisis. He does address a few issues, but not a major crisis. Paul is writing from jail, thanking God for the Philippians' concern for him while he's in prison, and sharing with them some wonderful news. First off, that their fellow church member who had come to visit, Epaphroditus, who had fallen ill and was close to death, is now well. And Paul will be sending him back very shortly. And secondly, that Paul's imprisonment in Rome has led to the gospel being shared throughout the household of Caesar, which, considering Nero was Caesar at the time, this is really good news. So the Philippian church had a special place in Paul's heart because, first off, it was the first church that he founded on European soil. And from that first day on, the Philippians have been faithful to Paul, supporting his ministries in other cities and helping tend for his needs whenever he found himself in prison. So Paul writes with the love of a father to children who have matured beyond parents' wildest dreams. Before I dig into chapter 4, I also wanted to share something I read by N.T. Wright this week, which has a bearing on Paul's message, although it starts out a little bit different. So N.T. Wright was talking about the ascension, and he comments, and he says, I know churches where there's a great east window with a picture of the ascension, and all you can see of Jesus is a cloud with 2 feet sticking down. And Wright goes on to say, first century Jews would not have seen it that way, nor would they have conceived of heaven as being somewhere in our universe. He said in the New Testament, when people talk about Jesus coming back again, often the word used is appears rather than descends. And Wright continues, as though Jesus is behind an invisible curtain, and one day the curtain will be removed, and we'll discover that he's been there all along. The reason this thought caught my mind is because that other reality behind the curtain, as Wright puts it, is the kingdom of God. And we're going to catch a couple glimpses behind that curtain in the fourth chapter of Philippians. So, to the letter. Now, like any letter from a loving father, Paul's letter is full of advice. And in this chapter, Paul's advice falls into one of two general categories. One, generosity and giving. And two, living the faith in daily life. In this chapter, living the faith comes first and giving comes second, but since we're coming up on stewardship time again, I thought I'd start with the giving part first and go there. So, Paul has just received a generous gift from the Philippians to help support him while he's in jail. And his initial response is somewhat surprising. He says, I rejoice in the Lord greatly for your concern for me. But then he immediately follows that with, not that I'm in need, for I've learned to be content with whatever I have. Paul knows how to live with little or plenty, how to be well fed or how to be hungry. He says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. In any case, it was kind of you to share my distress. What kind of thank you note is this? Then Paul calls to mind other times when the Philippians have been generous with him. When he left Macedonia, for instance, they were the only ones who supported him when he and he was ministering in Thessalonica. They helped out more than once. And I'm sure there are other times that Paul didn't list in the letter. Paul then adds, not that I seek the gift, but I seek the profit that accumulates to your account. I have been paid in full and have more than enough. The gifts you sent are a fragrant offering and a sacrifice acceptable and pleasing to God. And my God will fully satisfy every need of yours according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. I think we can do with a bit more of that mindset in the church. Too often, I hear messages that say or hint at, without your donation, this ministry is in danger or shutting down. That's an attitude of fear rather than faith. We may abound, we may abase, but if God's will is being done, the church will continue. For those who give, the clergy and vestry of this church are praying for God's blessing on you and are watching and waiting to see that prayer answered. For Paul, the focus of verse 17 is the profit that accumulates, or in the Greek, superabounds, to the accounts of those who give. Now, this is not a give so that you can get kind of thing. That's another mistake I hear from pulpits from time to time. But in God's economy, the oikonomos, the rule of the house, is one of continual giving and receiving, back and forth, like in the dance of a relationship, except that the giving, as it is given, is multiplied as it goes around, which is God's doing. And that's a bit of the kingdom breaking into our reality. Just about the whole letter of Philippians describes this godly economy in one way or another. In chapter 2, Paul talks about how Christ, though he was in the form of God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, and emptied himself, taking the form of a servant. And then when all was said and done, God exalted him and gave him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow. First Jesus gives, and then God gives, and both are blessed. In chapter 3, Paul talks about how he himself, whatever he gained from being raised a Jew and a Pharisee, he counts it all as rubbish, for the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. Paul gave up his past, his heritage, and God gave him a future and spiritual children like the Philippians. And all are blessed. In short, in the words of missionary Jim Elliott, as Christians, we give up what we cannot keep to gain what we cannot lose. So Paul rejoices in the Philippians game. Paul's second subject in this chapter, advice on how to live the faith, is also scattered throughout the letter. And one thing that keeps coming back throughout all those bits and pieces is the command, be of the same mind. Which is a difficult thing to do when we think about that. Be of the same mind. And again, we listen to Paul's words as we catch a glimpse of that vision behind the curtain. Chapter 1, verse 27, stand firm in one spirit, serving, striving, side by side with one mind for the gospel. Chapter 2, verse 2, be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Chapter 2, verse 5, let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. Chapter 2, verse 14, do all things without murmuring and arguing. And then chapter 3, verse 2, Paul takes a little bit of a detour by saying, beware of the dogs, beware of the evil workers, beware of those who mutilate the flesh. Okay? What he's talking about here is the Judaizers who are attempting to bring the teaching of Jewish circumcision into the Gentile church. And Paul says this is not necessary. Be of one mind about this, and don't be troubled by it. Chapter 3, verse 15, let those of us then who are mature be of the same mind. And then finally, in our own reading for today, chapter 4, verse 2, I urge Euodia and I urge Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. Euodia and Syntyche were not, as is sometimes been suggested, troublesome they would have gossips who had gotten on each other's last nerves. Paul describes the two women as co-workers in the gospel, people who have struggled alongside Paul in the ministry, together with Clement and the rest of Paul's co-workers. These were no spiritual lightweights. So it is possible for two deeply spiritual lovers of God to disagree on something. Paul's solution to the problem does not include sitting down and teaching them proper doctrine. Rather, Paul says in Greek, parakaleo, syntyche, parakaleo. Para as in parallel, kaleo as in call. I call the two of you together. And then he says to the disciples, help these women whose names are in the book of life. Christian unity is not the same thing as agreeing on everything. Paul's letter to the Philippians gives us a picture of the blueprint for how to be one in Christ and what that unity looks like. And it all comes back to where we began, with love, but not quite the love we as we usually understand it. Human love is imperfect, God's love is perfect, and here comes the kingdom again. Paul says, press on toward the goal of, for the prize of the heavenly call of God, Christ Jesus. What we've known before is nothing but rubbish compared to knowing Jesus. And so we press on to what's behind that curtain. But where do we start? And Paul points the way here. He says, find and beloved, whatever's true, whatever's honorable or venerable, whatever's just, whatever's pure or holy or innocent, whatever's pleasing or lovely, whatever's commendable, if there's any excellence or virtue, if there's anything worthy of praise, think on these things. Because of such are the kingdom of heaven. Interestingly, the phrase, think on these things in the Greek, is taken from the language of accounting. A better translation might be, keep track of these things. Stick them on your refrigerator. Or like Charlene, track them on the spreadsheet and give us a report once a week. Can you imagine if we actually did that? Keeping a list of all the good, lovely, and worthwhile things around us on a spreadsheet. We'd start looking for spreadsheet-worthy things in everything around us, even in people whose points of view differ from ours, even in our enemies. That may sound a little bit Pollyannish, and there are certainly times when we need to discuss difficult issues. But in the book of Matthew, Jesus says to the Pharisees, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. A good person brings good things out of a good treasure, and the evil person brings evil things out of an evil treasure. If we fill our minds and hearts with good things, then good things will come out of our mouths. And then words become actions, and actions become unity. Not that we're ever going to see perfection in this life, but it will head us in the direction of the kingdom. It's kind of like the old Christian comedian said, if you do all the things Scripture says to do, you won't have time to do the don'ts. In the same way, if we strive to think about and speak about only what's good stuff on our spreadsheet, we won't have time to be complaining, and life will change. And so I lay down the challenge for all of us, myself included. Whatever's true, whatever's honorable, whatever's just, whatever's pure, whatever's pleasing, whatever's commendable, if there's any excellence, if there's anything worthy of praise, think on these things, share these things. Keep track of these things. And the God of peace will be with you, right there on the other side of that curtain, closer than the year we breathe. So the essential message of Philippians is a message of joy and love. Paul says to the Philippians, you have done well, and you are doing well. Stand firm, and don't allow
distracted or misled by false teachers. Keep on loving God. Keep on loving each other. And God will abundantly supply all your needs according to his riches in Christ Jesus. May his blessing.